GPS played a trick on you, right? Well, believe it or not, this sounds kind of weird, but something like this has actually happened in the past, and I'm going to tell you two illustrations so you can understand. For many years, the marine charts, those that the people of boats use, and world maps showed a small island named Sandy Island off the northeast coast of Australia, west of New Caledonia in the Coral Sea. But when scientists from the University of Sydney in Australia traveled by boat to that area, they were surprised to discover there was nothing there but open ocean. Instead of an island, there was nothing there but the sea. Sandy Island had apparently disappeared. For most of you who likely are aware of this, when the sixth plague comes, and the seventh plague, you know, near before Jesus comes, this is interesting, islands disappear. So I want to be on solid ground somewhere, but not on the island.
Amen.
So it could actually disappear. Kathy and I were interested. I've been to Hawaii several times to do camp meetings and speak for ASI, and I remember we went to one of the national parks there, and it shows that, well, for most of you know that the main big island of Hawaii, on the Kona coast, if you're just like 100 feet offshore, it's like 1,000 feet deep there. Really, really deep. But on the Hilo side, there's a sandy beach for a ways. The point I'm going to make is, if you look at a cross-section of the ocean floor in these islands, they're just like big toadstools sticking up out of the, because they were volcanically, you know, lava came up and then it melted or cooled down. Anyway, so it wouldn't take much to knock them over and just right into the water. That sounds kind of weird, doesn't it? It's true.
It's true.
Interesting thing that I'll tell you about is sometimes islands could disappear, but what I'm going to show you is, without checking, people thought it was there. And most people thought that it appeared because it's on the map. They all believed it was there. But the reason it was on the map was because of, listen carefully, human error. Somebody put it on there, but it never existed, it never had. It's interesting. So one day it was on the maps and charts, the next day after they fixed the error, it was gone, simply disappeared. So I'm using this illustration to suggest to you that what if something that God had made disappeared from sight? And what if it was something that God said we should always keep in view? Isn't that interesting? The Bible begins, as I mentioned to you last night, with the most famous line in the history of literature, and it is, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. So I'd like for you guys to take your Bibles now, and let's go to Genesis chapters 1 and 2. And we're going to see something very, very interesting. Does anybody know how long it took God to create everything?
6 days.
People are saying 6 days. You know what the right answer is? 7. Okay, we'll see that in just a minute. I'm just kidding you a little bit, but the Bible does say that. So, you see, Genesis 1:1, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. That's Genesis 1:1. So then God created light, and he created the atmosphere and the dry land of vegetation and the seas and the sun and the moon and the stars and creatures of the water and of the air. A lot of people don't realize this, but there's lots of stuff going on under the water. If you've ever done scuba diving, you can see that there's fish everywhere. There's big eels and there's octopus and there's big turtles and all kinds of things under there. You would never have a clue if you were just looking at the top of the water. So he created all these things, big whales and so on. Pretty interesting. But on the sixth day, God created the land-dwelling animals, and finally on the sixth day, God created human beings in his own image, and we called them Adam and Eve, the first two. Each day of creation, after God looked at things, what did he say? Behold, it was
good.
But after creating man, what did he say?
Very
good. Now this is interesting. Listen carefully to what I'm going to tell you now. God was not finished yet. So we go now to chapter 2 and look at verse 2. This is Genesis chapter 2 and verse 2. And on the seventh day, which day did I say?
Seventh day,
God ended his work. And he rested from all the work which he had created and made. Now I want you to think about this word made. God made it. So I have the King James Version in my notes here, so I'll just read it there. On the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made. And he rested on the seventh day from all the work which he had made. Everybody see that? And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he had rested from all his work which he had created and made. So remember that. This is interesting. God made it. And I think it's very significant. So now we'll go to the fourth commandment. The sanctity and holiness of the Sabbath. Where are we going to look for the fourth commandment? Exodus chapter 20. Remember I told you last night something interesting about this. And that is, if you look at the Roman Catholic Church's catechism, and the big catechism and all the printed documents that they have, they leave out the second commandment. And it's very interesting because the second commandment, well, let's just look at it. This is Exodus chapter 20, starting with verse 3. The first commandment, you shall have no other gods before me. Now, 4, 5, and 6, those verses are left out of the Roman Catholic Church's catechism. It's interesting, because I want to show you what it says here. Not make for yourself any carved image or any likeness of anything that's in heaven above or that's in earth beneath or that's in the water under the earth. You should not bow down to them or serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquities of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generation to those that hate me. And I like verse 6. It's really amazing. And then, unfortunately, this is left out. But showing mercy to thousands to those who do what?
Love
me and keep my commandments. Jesus was quoting that in John 14, 15. If you love me, you will
keep my commandments.
So this is pretty interesting. But that's left out. So let's now go to the third commandment, and that's verse 7. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. What does it mean to take God's name in vain?
To call it without reason.
I'm hearing several good answers. Misusing God's name.
Yeah.
For example, in curse words. One of the worst curse words that people say all the time is, you know, GD. You understand? Same thing. Now, this is interesting, though. There's one other way you take God's name in vain, and that is hypocrisy. You claim to be a Christian, and you're not. Don't act like it. I remember one time a young man was going off to a logging camp to work for the summer, and his family told him, well, you have to be a real witness there because these people are going to be cursing, they're going to be doing all kinds of bad stuff, and you have to be a real witness. So when the summer was over, he came back and said, how did things go? And he said, well, just fine. How did that happen? No one knew I was a Christian. You get the idea? If you just blend in, there's no problems. So we're going to look now at remember the Sabbath day. It's interesting that this eighth verse is the only one of the commandments that begins with the word remember. Now, I'll show you in a minute why you can say remember, but let's go on. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. You understand what labor and do all your work is? Most of us have jobs that we work at 40 hours a week or thereabouts, right? That's where we labor. That's our job. I frequently ask people when I meet them, what kind of work are you involved in? It's just a little introductory conversation thing. What kind of work are you involved in? And they'll tell me, and I tell them what I've done. And then, what does it say? All your labor and what? All your work. Now, this is interesting. Do you think people have other work besides what they do for a living?
Yes.
They work on their house, they do their yard, they maintain their cars, and they do all kind of stuff. They do baking and, you know, managing the house and so on. You have 6 days to do your work, your labor and all your work, which is interesting. So I like to, we have about 2 acres that we mow at our house. And fortunately, we don't. The other day, I pushed mowed about 2 acres, and I got 21,000 steps. I don't have that watch on today, my Fitbit. But anyway, fortunately, we have help with the riding mower. But what I'm going to tell you is, I don't do that on Sabbath. I usually do it on Thursday or Friday, so it looks pretty for Sabbath, you know, and I can enjoy it a little bit. But now we're going to go on here. 6 days you labor, do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall not do any work, nor you, nor your son, nor your daughter, your male or your female servant, or your cattle, or your stranger that's in your gates. Now this is interesting. God says nobody's going to work on that day. Nobody that works for you, nobody who lives in your house, and even the stranger within your gates. You have guests in your house? You tell them, we keep Sabbath in our house. So you're going to be with us, we're going to keep Sabbath together. It's not, well, I don't guess you keep the Sabbath, so we won't either. You believe that happens sometimes?
Yeah.
It does. It shouldn't. Then it says, even your animals should rest. And then the big reason why. I like this one. And I wrote it in my notes. Why is that? Because the Bible says, for what? What does it mean? Because. 6 days the Lord made the heavens and earth, the sea, and all that's in them, and rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. That's almost exact quote from Genesis 2, verse 3. So it harks back to creation. Listen carefully. As Amira mentioned last night, marriage and the Sabbath both came to us before sin in the Garden of Eden. Is this true? Very interesting. So it's not Jewish. If you're a man and a woman, you keep the Sabbath. That's important. It's for you.
Amen.
But I want to tell you something interesting. Why did God rest on the seventh day? The man that I was telling you about and his pastor couldn't figure out, why did God rest? Surely he wasn't tired. I mean, if he can do stuff like that, he doesn't get tired about it.
Be an example for us.
That's exactly right, to give us an example. That same reason Jesus was baptized, because he told John the Baptist to fulfill all righteousness. In other words, I'm showing you an example of what I should do. So there's a few exceptions to being baptized, like the thief on the cross, you can't come down and get baptized. But if you have the opportunity, you should be, because Jesus set the example. Isn't that true? Okay, now we're going to look at some interesting things here. Isaiah wrote that those who kept the Sabbath and made it a delight would delight in the Lord, and God would rise and cause them to ride in the high places of the earth. Where's that found?
Isaiah
58, 12 through 14. Real interesting. Throughout the Old Testament times, God is faithful, and his faithful people always kept the Sabbath. Not surprisingly, as important as the Bible Sabbath is declared to be, mankind has arrived at a place where the Sabbath that was, according to Jesus' words, made for man, has all but disappeared from the Christian landscape. Even those 99% of the people who keep Sunday don't really keep Sunday, because there's no biblical illustration of how you should keep it. Is that right? And no promised blessings. Very interesting. Once written with the finger of God on stone, the biblical Sabbath is coming the way of Sandy Island. Most people today claim that the Bible is their guide, their weekly day of rest and holy day isn't Sabbath as we understand from Scripture. So the importance of the biblical Seventh-day Sabbath pointed to the words of Jesus himself recorded in all four Gospels. Now I'm going to tell you an interesting story right now so you can understand how significant this is. All four of the Gospels tell one story, and that is the life and ministry of Jesus. The first three, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, are what we call synoptic Gospels, and frequently they say the same thing. John was written as, listen, one of the last books of the Bible, the Gospel of John. I've been studying for a presentation I'm going to make in the near future, and many Bible scholars, including J. N. Andrews, who wrote History of the Sabbath, Uriah Smith, who wrote Daniel and Revelation, and this is Matthew 12 and Mark 2 and Luke the 6th chapter. An event happened on the Sabbath. Now it's interesting that on purpose, Jesus performed seven of his primary miracles on what day?
Sabbath.
Sabbath. Now this is interesting. I want to show you why in just a minute. On this particular Sabbath, the disciples were walking through some grain fields. Apparently the path went through an area on both sides where they had planted grain. And the disciples were hungry, so they walked. As they walked along, they picked some of the grain. You could just strip it off. You know, you've seen wheat, how it grows. And it has an outside kernel on it. You can just rub it like that and get it off and blow it away. And then if you eat it, you know what it tastes like? It tastes like wheat, but the consistency is almost like gum. Have you ever done that? It's gluten-like type stuff. Anyway, they were not harvesting. They were satisfying their hunger. Is this true?
Amen.
It is almost common today that if you walk through someone's orchard, you can eat an apple, but you can't take a basket full with you. You understand? Well, at any rate, this is kind of interesting because the paparazzi criticized Jesus for having harvesting on the Sabbath. But Jesus' response was profound and enlightening. And so I want you to turn now to Mark, the second chapter. We're going to look at something very interesting. First of all, before we get there, let me ask you a question. Do you remember when we were reading Genesis chapter 2, verses 2 and 3, that the word I emphasized?
Made.
So we're going to go down to Mark chapter 2 and look at verses 26 and, 27 and 28. And he said to them, does everybody have it now? This is Mark 2, 27 and 28. The Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. In other words, God is not saying, here's the day, you guys have to keep it. If you're legalistic, you can say, what can I do and what I can't do on the Sabbath? But this is the Sabbath was made for man. Then he also said, the Son of Man is Lord also of the Sabbath. That's verse 28. Now I'm going to ask you two questions right now. How did he know the Sabbath was made? Not difficult, is it? Because he made it. That's pretty interesting. How could he be Lord of the Sabbath? Because he made it. Very, very interesting. By the way, the true God is the one who made everything. Kathy and I had the unique opportunity I mentioned last night of going to India a few years ago to conduct an evangelistic meeting. And we did some research on the Andhra Pradesh state where we were going, and we found that most of the people there are Hindu. Now, the Hindus have 300,000 gods. So if I tell them about Jesus Christ, they say, fine, we've got 300,001. What's next? You get the point? But this is really, really interesting because over in Daniel, in his books, when King Nebuchadnezzar was told the dreams and so on, he kept saying, your God is the King of Kings. He's the big one, you know, the one of everything. So if you want to make an impression to Hindus, you have to say, our God made, what's the next word?
Your God.
Everything, including the stuff you make your gods out of. Mm-hmm. Pretty interesting. So, I'll tell you one other one. When the Israelites came to the area of crossing the Jordan River the first time, you know, after leaving Mount Sinai coming there, they sent the spies in, one man from each tribe, and they came back there. It's beautiful. It's just like he said it was. It's better than he said it was. In fact, we got this big bunch of grapes. It took two guys to carry one clump of grapes. You can remember that. Amazing. Beautiful. Land flowing with milk and honey. But we also saw these giants in there, these big guys. There's no way we can overcome them. And Caleb and Joshua ramped their clothes around and said, no, 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 we can do it. God's going to take us right in there. And he remembered all the miracles. You know, this is pretty interesting. But they turned around and went back in the wilderness. A day for a year, the 40 days that they searched out the land. You guys understand that Bible prophecy thing. 40 years back in the wilderness. When they came back the second time, listen to this now, it's really amazing. This is in the book of Joshua. When Joshua was sent in two spies to the city of Jericho and said, find out what it's like there, how we can get into that place, because it's a big walled city. Well, they got inside, okay, but then the guys were told, the authorities, if you please, there's these guys in here that are spies. Well, they went and hid at the house of Rahab, the harlot, you remember. It's very, very interesting. And then she told them, I'm not sure where they are. If you run out that way, you might catch them, you know, before dark. So they, when they left, she went up and talked to them. She said, we know there's no way we're going to withstand you guys. How did she, what'd she say next? We know that your God is the creator of heaven and earth. We know that your God opened the Red Sea. We know that your God fed you with manna for 40 years. Well, that was later when the 40-year manna came up. The interesting part was this. We were so scared we couldn't even fight.
That's right.
Isn't that true? It's a cakewalk. You couldn't come right in here because your God is the creator of heaven and earth. That's the point that I wanted to make. Okay. We're going to go on to a little bit more of this interesting topic because I want some amazing things to share with you. There are three places in the New Testament where it says that Jesus Christ himself was the creator. So you can write down the references and then we'll look at a couple of them. The first one is John, the first chapter. John, Gospel of John, chapter 1. And we'll look at the first three verses. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him. What's that word? All things were made. And without him nothing was made that was made. Now who is this Word? Well, we know that because we look at verse 14, and it says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Who did that? Jesus Christ. Very, very interesting. Okay, now we're going to go, you can write down the next verse, and it's Colossians chapter 1. So you have John chapter 1, Colossians chapter 1, and also Hebrews chapter 1. The reason I'm telling you all of this is we need to be grounded in the fact that the Bible is true about what it says.
That's
and this
right.
is very interesting. Okay, Colossians chapter 1, looking at verse 13. Colossians chapter 1, verse 13. He has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed unto us the kingdom of the Son of his love. In whom, this is in the Son, we have redemption through his blood and forgiveness of sins. He is the invisible image of God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through him and for him. So this is again talking about Christ. Then the last one we'll look at is Hebrews chapter 1.
Yep.
And this is verses 1 and 2. God, who at various times and in various ways spoke to us in the past by the fathers, I think the King James says sundry times, has in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, and through whom he also made the world. Interesting. So you have that. You look at verse 10, the beginning, he laid the foundation of the earth and the heavens are the work of his hands, and so on. So here's something interesting. The weekly cycle was made by God at creation. And it has no other source.
Amen.
Does anybody know what time it is exactly right now?
9:27.
About 9:27 a.m. Eastern Daylight Time, right? How do we know that?
Look at the watch.
Well, our watches tell us. Does anybody know where we set time in the world?
No, because God is.
Well, Greenwich Mean Time, Greenwich, England, is the place where you set your clocks to begin to start the time, and we trace from there. But time is set in the United States on the grounds of the U.S. Naval Observatory, where the Vice President's residence is. And this is interesting because they have a telescope on a fixed mount that looks up through the sky, and every 23 minutes, 59 minutes and so many seconds, a certain star will pass over the top of that. When it sends its beam of light down to the crosshairs of the grid, time is set for the whole Earth. Even atomic clocks are set by the stars.
Wow.
It's very interesting. So we know when a year passes because the Earth makes the full rotation around the sun.
Yeah.
A month is what?
The moon
making its cycle, a full rotation. And it has its waxing stage and its waning stage, and then starts over again in a month. Real interesting. How do we know when a day passes?
Sun goes up, and well, the rotation of the Earth.
That's it. The real interesting part is it's the rotation of the Earth. It appears the sun is coming up. People used to think the sun was rotating around the Earth,
no,
but we know it the other way around. Anyway, how do we know when a week passes?
We don't, because only God set that time.
It's only set by God. And scientists can show us that the weekly cycle has been kept forever and ever since there was Earth time. Now I'm going to show you something amazing. I am not a musician, but I'm going to be bold enough to tell you something interesting. Even the number 7 governs the music world.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people don't understand this. Most people think there are 8 notes in an octave, just as there are 8 sides to an octagon, but no, an octave has only 7 notes. You guys can sing along with me if you'd like. Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti. And how many did I say?
7.
If you say do again, that's number 8, and that starts the new octave. Pretty interesting. There are as many notes in the scale as there are days in the week. Pretty interesting. It seems that all the life rhythms move in rhythms of 7. So I have a thing here I'm going to show you that is pretty interesting to me. This is just the photo cover of a DVD that was done by Lauren Cole. I bought this at ASI last year. But Lauren Cole lives in Northern California in the Modoc National Forest. It's a very remote area where loggers and campers mostly go. But he lives nearby, and they were up there one day and noticed there was a beaver dam. Now, I don't know how many of you have been around beavers very much, but my father was in the logging business, so we know a lot about beavers. We've seen beaver dams and their beaver houses and all that stuff, and the beaver swimming and so on. Anyway, Lauren went up there on Sabbath to show his family, and there were no beavers in the lake, in their little pond. He couldn't figure it out. Maybe they moved downstream or going upstream. Sometimes they move to get closer to better food, you know. Anyway, he went back the next day, and they were out swimming again. For 10 years, he recorded them with video and recording devices, and they never, ever worked on Sabbath.
Wow.
Is that incredible? He has his videos. Wow. Here they are. He's got 3 or 4 beavers in one picture. They're moving stuff around and building their house. And he would break the dam a little bit, and they would come back the next day and repair it. You know, that they could do it real simple. At any rate, but whenever he came on Sabbath, they were never working. They have this circadian rhythm, but it's called a circa-septum rhythm, which is based on the cycle of 7. And he thought, well, maybe they've died or something got them. They've all been poisoned. But he went up to their house. The beaver house is just a big stack of sticks, but inside it's hollow. And he put his microphone up there, and he heard, meep, 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 meep. They're all talking to each other. That's not a beaver sound. It's my interpretation. But anyway, they were in there, but they don't even come out on Sabbath. And they found that there's hives of bees in Southern California that never go out on Sabbath either. It's kind of interesting. I'm going to give you an illustration of some of this. Life all seems to move in rhythms of 7. It's called chronobiology. Franz Hallberg of the University of Minnesota is widely considered the father of chronobiology. He's a tall Romanian gentleman who works in an office crammed with journals and papers and stuff he's produced over the years. But he insists that in addition to a circadian rhythm, you guys understand circadian rhythm? That means that if you get up at the same time every day, you don't have to set your clock. Most of us don't set, a long time I ever set a clock when I go to the airport. I want to make sure that I'm not going to miss my airplane. Because they don't wait for anybody, unless they're late. I went for my annual physical to the doctor in Maryland several years ago, and they wanted me to sign a paper that if I was late for my appointment, they would charge me anyway. And I said, well, wait, there's no place for the doctor to sign. What if he's late? That would be a unilateral contract. We want a bilateral contract. Now I'm going to tell you something interesting. Franz Hallberg and many others, I'll tell you a little bit more about some of the others, have researched and uncovered conditions about us as humans that seem to rise and fall with the seven-day cycle. They include heartbeat, blood pressure, body temperature, hormone levels, acid content of the blood, red blood cell count, oral temperature, female breast temperature, urine chemistry, and volume, the ratio between two important neurotransmitters, that's epinephrine, there it is, and the flow of the several body chemicals, stress coping hormones like cortisol. Even the common cold is circumceptive. For example, if you get a cold, if you take medicine, you're going to get well in 7 days. If you don't take medicine, you still get well in 7 days. Is this true? Pretty interesting. It's the 7 day cycle. Doctors recognize that if people that are exposed to malaria, if they get the malaria infection and even a pneumonia crisis, peaks at 7 days. Chickenpox always comes exactly 2 weeks, two 7 day cycles after you've been exposed to chickenpox. A person will tend to have an increase in swelling on the seventh day and the 14th day of the surgery. Organ transplanters, people who have organ transplant, face similar crises because the body's immune system attacks the newly introduced foreign object every 7 days. So the 7th day, the 14th day, the 21st day, the doctors always have to be available to give you the anti-rejection medication so that you can continue to keep the new organ if it's fitting plainly. Chronobiology is the study of how living things handle time. It is now clear that major universities, medical centers around the world, there are chronobiologists at the National Aeronautic and Space Administration, or NASA, as also the National Institute of Health studying this. Chronobiology is becoming a mainstream in science. It's studying how the seven-day cycle works in humans. Now, this is pretty interesting. Society's seven-day calendar is the only major rhythm in human activity that is totally oblivious to external nature, as I just mentioned. It doesn't have to do with sun, moon, stars. The deeper we investigate the inner workings of life, we can see something amazing. These are almost mind-boggling. The interesting thing that I'll tell you is that God has used a masterful design and uses time itself to create rest in his creatures. By the way, the lub-dub of your heart, part of it's the rest cycle. Isn't that true? It beats and then rests and so on. God's words are so majestic, so exciting, so unbelievable, beyond our mundane world, that we can only comprehend that it came from God himself. Now, I want to tell you one other interesting thing. Dan Buettner's article about the blue zones, you guys ever remember hearing about the blue zones? In the November 2005 issue of National Geographic magazine, pointed out that people living in Loma Linda, California, live 7 to 10 years longer than the average population of America. Buettner stated in his article that one of the unique lifestyle factors of this group is they observe the seventh-day Sabbath as a weekly day of rest. Now we're beginning to see why it matters. They're simply in sync with the rhythm of life. Very interesting. There's much more I can tell you about this, and I'm actually leaving out some, but I want to tell you about some real interesting things that we can find out. Let's go now to the 16th chapter of Exodus. This is before the Ten Commandments were given. And something amazing, I wrote these in my notes, so I'll just refer to it. But Exodus 16, verse 4. If you want to know a miracle, does anybody know how many people left Egypt?
Over a million.
When they counted them, they had 600,000 men age 20 and above suitable for war. So most people think that with wives and children, there were probably 2 million people who went out of Egypt. How are they going to be fed? This is like a trainload of food every day. It's pretty amazing. So let's look at this. Exodus, the 16th chapter, and verse 4. Then God said unto Moses, Behold, I will rain bread from heaven for you, and all the people shall go out and gather on a certain day every day, that I may prove them whether they will walk in my law or no. In other words, this is a test whether they're going to keep the commandments. And on the sixth day, it came to pass that on the sixth day they shall prepare that which they bring in, and it will be twice as much as they gather daily. Well, you remember something interesting happened. Some of the people gathered more on a day other than Friday. Oh, I should also tell you this. According to the Bible, only two of the weekly days have names. Is it true? What are they? Preparation Day and Sabbath. All the other days are simply work days. Ezekiel 46, verse 1 says the working days and the Sabbath, the six working days and the Sabbath. So this is interesting. But when they gathered more than they should have on any day except Friday, what happened to it? It spoiled. Now, the Bible says it stank. And it got worms in it. Oh, mercy. Only a Robin or something would be interested in that, but not a person. At any rate, if they got more than they needed on Friday, what happened to it? It was well preserved. How much came on Sabbath?
None.
Now, this is interesting, so we're going to look at it. Look at verse 26. This is chapter 16 of Exodus, verse 26. 6 days you shall gather, but on the seventh day, which is the Sabbath, that there shall be none. And it came to pass there went out some of the people on the seventh day to gather, and they found none. And the Lord said unto Moses, how long refuse you to keep my commandments and my laws? Mm-hmm. Now, the laws haven't even been given yet, right? Mm-hmm. How do you suppose people knew about God's commandments and his laws? It's called word of mouth. Now, as we get near the 100 mark, many of us get old and senile, but the people before the flood lived to be 900 years old. So they could tell their kids, you know, here's what God said, here's what God said, here's what God said. And it was true all the time. They could connect with each other. But notice this one, verse 30 and 35. So the people rested on the seventh day. And then verse 35, the children of Israel did eat manna. How long? 40 years until they came to the land of the inhabited. They ate manna until they came to the borders of the land of Canaan. Well, this is interesting to me because God did a miracle about Sabbath every week for 40 years to get them in the system of Sabbath keeping. This to me is very simple and very, very interesting. Now, I want to give you a little illustration. On two different periods of recorded history of God's people, Israel, they were subjected to bondage. They were made slaves. The first was the 400 years in Egypt, and the second was the 70-year captivity in Babylon. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm going to tell you something interesting here. In 605 BC, the armies of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, besieged Jerusalem. And Daniel and his friends were part of that group that were, you know, being besieged. They could only remember that 100 years before, the Assyrians had come and taken the 10 tribes of Israel captive and assimilated them into the land of Syria. Listen carefully. They were never, ever heard from again. Have you ever heard of the 10 lost tribes of Israel? Yeah. That's them. They never heard from again. So Daniel's thinking, little Israel, Judah and Benjamin, that's all we've got left, and now we're going to be taken to Babylon in captivity. This is the end of us. Until Jeremiah said, 70 years and you're going to be coming back home.
Yeah.
Isn't that interesting? So many of the people died there, but just the generations and some of the young people came back. But at any rate, this is interesting. Why did God allow the people to go into captivity to Babylon?
Because they wouldn't listen to him.
There are two reasons, and I want to show them to you in Ezekiel 20, verse 16. Ezekiel 20, verse 16. We know Ezekiel 20, verse 12 and 20 talk about the Sabbath as a sign and so on. But this one is interesting. It says, because they despised my judgments, did not walk in my statutes, but profaned my Sabbaths, and their heart went after idols. So their two reasons were they didn't keep the Sabbath, and they worshipped other gods. They weren't really gods, like Baal and so on. So even Leviticus 26, God said, the land, I'm just going to tell you this reference, you can write it down, we won't look at it, I'll just read it from my notes here. Leviticus 26, 34, says, then the land shall enjoy its Sabbaths as long as it lies desolate, and you are in your enemy's land, then it shall rest and enjoy its Sabbaths. Because the land got its Sabbath rest too, every 7 years, you remember, they didn't plant their crops and so on. And it lies desolate as long as it... for this rest, as long as it did not rest on the Sabbath when you dwelt in it. Well, it's very interesting. I want to give you this amazing statement. From the time the Jews returned back to Jerusalem in Palestine from the Babylonian captivity until the time of Jesus 500 years later, listen carefully, they never again worshiped idols, period. They learned their lesson. So when Jesus came, were there idols everywhere? Were there high places and all that? No, they never did it again. Unfortunately, in order to rectify the other problem, remember the first two, the reason they went into captivity was they worshipped idols and they didn't keep the Sabbath properly. In order to rectify the other problem for not keeping the Sabbath, they overreacted and set up very stringent man-made laws for keeping the breaking the Sabbath. Instead of resting on the Sabbath and having the Sabbath a delight, they set up these legalistic rules of how to keep the Sabbath holy. So instead of being a blessing to people, it became a burden. Very interesting. So Jesus is sometimes criticized as not keeping the Sabbath, but what he's trying to do is get people back to proper Sabbath keeping. You understand? Jesus was a Sabbath keeper, we know that. Very interesting. But he did those things. He says, it's lawful to do good on the Sabbath. It's evident that Jesus was a Sabbath keeper. However, he endeavored to show by his example the true spirit of Sabbath keeping. He performed, as I mentioned, 7 miracles on Sabbath. Does anybody remember any one of those miracles? You remember all of them. One is he healed the man at the pool of Bethesda, remember, on Sabbath. Rise, take up your bed and walk. That was one of the most interesting questions Jesus ever asked. Would you like to be made well? Would you like to be made well? What do you mean? Nobody's going to put me in the water. Then there's the man that had the withered hand. And there was another one. Let me try to think. Oh, the guy that was born blind. And they tried to get his parents to verify. He said, well, he's an adult. Let him answer for himself. And they didn't get thrown out. You remember? So then Jesus said in Mark 7, howbeit in vain they worship me. This is Mark 7, verse 7 and following. Howbeit in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. Laying aside the commandment of God, you uphold the traditions, and so on. So that's when Jesus said the Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. And he said that because he made the Sabbath. So listen to this little scenario that I put up. Here is this man who is working two jobs to make ends meet. He's got a lot of unfinished projects around the house, and he says, happy Sabbath. I'm so glad it's Sabbath. Because I can lay aside all of my work, my projects, and rest from all the stress of it all. All my home projects, my lawn, my cars, and so on, will just have to wait. I'm going to go follow God's example of worship on the Sabbath with my family and with God's people, and go and spend some quality time with my children. Now this, to me and my family, this is very, very interesting. Jesus meant when he says he was Lord of the Sabbath that he's the one that made it. So I'm going to give you a couple of illustrations that you'll be able to see. The Sabbath in our study is another amazing reason to keep the Sabbath. Do you guys know that the Sabbath, the Ten Commandments are given twice in the Bible?
Yes.
The first time is Exodus 20. Where's the second time?
Deuteronomy,
the fifth chapter. So if you know that Deuteronomy is Jesus' last four sermons to Israel. Excuse me, these are Moses' last four sermons to Israel. Inspired by the Lord, of course, but he's giving these four sermons and repeating all the good stuff God did for them. So in Deuteronomy chapter 5, I want you to notice verse 12, 13, and 14. And it's to 15 where it is. But this is the amazing part. It's just like, almost word for word, the fourth commandment of the 20th chapter of Exodus, except one difference. Here it is. Observe the Sabbath day to keep it holy, as the Lord your God commanded you. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. This is verse 13, Deuteronomy 5. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God, in it you shall do no work, you nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your male servant, nor your female servant, nor your ox, nor your donkey, or anything, nor any of your cattle, nor the strangers within your gates, or your male servant, or your female servant may rest as well. Does that sound like the fourth commandment in Exodus?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Now, remember it says 4 and 6 days the Lord created heaven and earth in Exodus 20, but here it says, and remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt, and the Lord your God brought you out from there with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. Therefore, the Lord your God command you to keep the Sabbath holy. So now we have two reasons for keeping the Sabbath. One is creation memorial. The other one is what? Redemption memorial. Very, very interesting. Believe it or not, I'm going to talk later this morning about how to prepare for the devil's last great temptation. And one of the things is to be sure you get out of debt, be faithful with God, and so on. The real interesting part about all of this is that God doesn't need the money. He just needs our faithfulness and our concern for him, of course. But to remember that we're all slow. And I tell people, you'll never be free till you're debt-free.
That's right.
The devil would like to keep us in bondage. And when I was listening to Amira's presentation last night, I thought, the devil is just working overtime, causing problems in the church and around the world. And the reason is, he knows that he has but a short time. Take a lesson from the devil. We know that time is short. Pretty interesting. Sabbath is a memorial of our salvation in Christ, as well as a memorial of his creation. One thing interesting to me, sometimes people have very tragic ends to their life. Some people get burned up in house fires, burned clear up. Is that right? Some people have been lost at sea, have been eaten by sharks, become part of a shark. Is that a problem for the Creator?
No.
Not at all. He has our RNA and DNA all in his heavenly computer, and he can just make me an instant warts and all. Maybe with brown hair the second time. Now I'm going to share with you something interesting. Jesus really is the ultimate rest, and he's bringing that to us, wonderful promises. I like these ideas that we can see. Over the years of my life, when I've talked to people, I've never heard anyone say, while looking back on their life, I wish I had spent more time at the office. Have you ever? But when they look back, they say, I wish I'd spent more time with my children. They grew up so fast, and now they're gone. I wish I'd spent more time with my spouse and with God. Thank God. He has made provision for a life without regrets.
Amen.
because he has given us a full 24 hours every week of our lives to lay aside our earthly cares and concentrate on what really matters, God, family, friends, and those who could use our encouragement. And it's really interesting. I was telling Kathy after breakfast, we were walking back to our room here, that this place looks so well built. It looks like it's hardy board or something on the side of the buildings, and they've got metal roofs and so on. You think it's impervious to fire?
Mm-hmm.
Someday everything on this campground, my home and all the stuff I own, is going to get burned up.
Mm-hmm.
And that will reduce its value considerably, as you can imagine.
Yeah.
The real interesting part about all of this is that we're going to heaven, my friends.
Yeah.
We don't even need a suitcase.
Yeah.
I like that. The Sabbath is an oasis in time, given to refresh and nourish us on our journey through life. Someone asked me, will your church let you do this on Sabbath? Well, my church doesn't have anything to do with it, because it's my relationship with God. If I have an appointment, something interesting happened. And I don't tell this very often, but we live on Southeast End Road in Strawberry Plains, Tennessee. And that we live actually in the house that Kathy was raised in. And this happened this way. We bought a real pretty 7 acres of land overlooking the lake and the mountains down in Tennessee to build our retirement home. But in the meantime, Kathy's parents both passed away. So Kathy and her brother and sister, the three of them inherited the little house that she was raised in. And they want, her brother and sister both live in Michigan, and they want to just sell the house and divide the money and, you know, do with it what they want to. Well, we decided, why don't we buy them out and keep the house?
Mm-hmm.
So we're in the process of selling our lake lot. And we have actually refurbished the whole house. It cost us more than it would have been to build a new house, but it has all these memories. And it's a nice little house on 24 acres of land, a beautiful spot. Anyway, we had 26 new doors and windows, and all of wiring's been done, all the plumbing's been done, and so on. And we put vinyl siding over the old white outside. It looks like a new little house. It's very nice. It's comfortable, but we don't have to look back when Jesus comes. You understand?
Amen.
It's a little house that gave us good comfort. The point I'm trying to make of all of this, these things are going to get burned up someday. And even though we really like them. But knowing God as your creator and savior will be a real anchor in the storm. The Sabbath is an island in the ocean, and it really does exist. Unlike Sandy Island, it really does exist. It's the Sabbath. So one of the most critical knowledge under heaven is the word remember. So I'm going to give you a little idea that the Sabbath was made for man. Many of you have had jobs, or you've been to the HR office in your place of business, and when you come to a new job, they'll say, well, your workstation's going to be over here, and you know, it's air-conditioned here, and you can work during rainstorms or whatever in the cold of winter. You even have a view of the outside. Oh, and let me tell you about the benefits. This is interesting. The best jobs are those with good wages and working conditions, but very important third factor called benefits. You guys ever heard of benefits? They say you get 2 weeks paid vacation when you first start, and if you stay with us for a while, it would increase a little bit. Paid vacation, what does that mean? Well, that means that when your vacation time comes, you can be at Myrtle Beach, or you can be at Charleston, or you can be at Disneyland, or you can be with home with your family, swinging in the hammock, and we'll pay you just like you were at work. Is that a benefit or not? Another one is paid holidays. About six times a year, when Monday's a holiday, you can have the day off. We'll pay you just like you were at work. Pretty interesting. Paid sick days, health insurance for you and your family, life insurance, group life insurance policy, profit sharing. Now listen carefully to what I'm going to tell you next. It would be a rare person indeed who would tell his employer, no thanks, I don't need the benefits, I'd like to opt out of the benefits package. That'd be kind of goofy, wouldn't it? So God has given us, as his workers, his Sabbath. Friday sundown to Saturday sunset, a day of rest, reflection, worship, and fellowship. And that is as great a benefit plan as you could imagine. There are real tangible benefits to Sabbath keeping. I know that God has greatly blessed our family because of Sabbath. Does anybody have such a stressful week that you're just glad when Sabbath comes? That's what we're talking about. Okay. Now, Jesus said Sabbath was made for man, so he's telling all of us that the Sabbath is made to help us and be a blessing to us, not a burden. It's part of God's benefit plan for everyone. He wants us to opt into his special day, fully participating to receive these full benefits. So let me just give you this. To me, it's kind of interesting. Imagine having one day every week to avoid work, to get out of household chores, a day of not doing anything on your to-do list, a day of and all of this without any guilt. Picture a day to spend with your family and your friends, a day in nature, a day of doing something nice for someone. It's not a dream, it's a reality, it's the Sabbath.
Amen.
I'm telling you all this because the Sabbath is such a great thing, you should be willing to be a 1%er because the 1% are right.
Amen.
God set the example for us. He rested on the seventh day of creation. He didn't need to rest, but he set the example for us. He showed us by example that he designed us to keep it holy, the whole rest for the whole day, 24 hours, to rejuvenate physically, emotionally, and most important, spiritually. The Sabbath means to cease or to stop. That's pretty interesting. When we stop chasing our material goals and our usual work for one day a week, we effectively say, God, you're in control. I'm honoring you. I'm focusing on you, on your Sabbath. Even though I'm working only 6 days, I trust you to provide for me all through the 7 days. It doesn't matter how much money I could make today or how much I could do off, check off my to-do list. Kathy and I both have these to-do lists because as you get older, you forget stuff. So you have to write down these things and you can scratch it off. Sometimes I even write something down on it that I've already done so I can scratch it off. But the Sabbath is an option with God. And I want to enjoy this time. I want to reset my thinking and honor God. So Friday sunset to Sabbath sunset, it's the biblical Sabbath. And during that period of time, God's faithful people come together to worship God collectively as his people. We all have the choice to follow Jesus' example and opt in to the benefits. And I think we should do that, don't you?
Amen.
Now, I want to close by just telling you this kind of a conclusion statement. Believe it or not, you have to believe what I just told you so much that you would die for it. Nobody would ever die for a day, but you would die for the Lord of the Sabbath. Do you understand? This is his day. He calls it my holy day. Over and over in the Bible. My Sabbath. Hallow my Sabbath. There'll be a sign. And so on. So the reason this is about as straight religious liberty as you can get. The big deal is this is where it's going to all focus around. There are two things at the end that will be the devil's greatest temptation. One is to break the Sabbath. And the other one is to focus on the natural immortality of the soul. Where you get spiritualism in there. But this one is the religious liberty one. It's really, really big. So I want you to understand that we have it on good evidence from God's holy word that the seventh day is the Sabbath, long before there was ever a Jew, long before there was ever sin. And God said, I made it for you.
Amen.